Eugenics and Other Evils by G.K. Chesterton. Introduction to the Reader. I publish these essays at the present time for a particular reason connected with the present situation, a reason which I should like briefly to emphasize and make clear. Though most of the conclusions, especially towards the end, are conceived with reference to recent events, the actual bulk or preliminary notes about the science of eugenics were written before the war. It was a time when this theme was the topic of the hour, when eugenic babies, not visibly very distinguishable from other babies, sprawled all over the illustrated papers, when the evolutionary fancy of Nietzsche was the new cry among the intellectuals, and when Mr. Bernard Shaw and others were considering the idea that to breed a man like a cart horse was the true way to attain that higher civilization of intellectual magnanimity and sympathetic insight which may be found in cart horses. It may therefore appear that I took the opinion too controversially, and it seems to me that I sometimes took it too seriously. But the criticism of eugenics soon expanded of itself into a more general criticism of a modern craze for scientific officialism and strict social organization. And then the hour came when I felt, not without relief, that I might well fling all my notes into the fire. The fire was a very big one, and was burning up bigger things than such pedantic quackeries. And anyhow, the issue itself was being settled in a very different style. Scientific officialism and organization in the state, which had specialized in them, had gone to war with the older cultures of Christendom. Either Prussianism would win, and the protest would be hopeless, or Prussianism would lose, and the protest would be needless. As the war advanced from poison gas to piracy against neutrals, it grew more and more plain that the scientifically organized state was not increasing in popularity. Whatever happened, no Englishman would ever again go nosing round the stinks of that low laboratory. So I thought all I had written irrelevant, and put it out of my mind. I am greatly relieved to say that it is not irrelevant. It has gradually grown apparent to my astounded gaze that the ruling classes in England are still proceeding on the assumption that Prussia is a pattern for the whole world. If parts of my book are nearly 9 years old, most of their principles and proceedings are a great deal older. They can offer us nothing but the same stuffy science, the same bullying bureaucracy, and the same terrorism by tenth-rate professors that have led the German Empire to its recent conspicuous triumph. For that reason, 3 years after the war with Prussia, I collect and publish these papers. Part 1, The False Theory, Chapter 1, What is Eugenics? The wisest thing in the world is to cry out before you are hurt. It is no good to cry out after you are hurt, especially after you are mortally hurt. People talk about the impatience of the populace, but sound historians know that most tyrannies have been possible because men moved too late. It is often essential to resist a tyranny before it exists. It is no answer to say, with distant optimism, that the scheme is only in the air. A blow from a hatchet can only be parried while it is in the air. There exists today a scheme of action, a school of thought, as collective and unmistakable as any of those by whose grouping alone we can make any outline of history. It is as firm a fact as the Oxford movement, or the Puritans of the Long Parliament, or the Jansenists, or the Jesuits. It is a thing that can be pointed out. It is a thing that can be discussed. And it is a thing that can still be destroyed. It is called, for convenience, eugenics. And that it ought to be destroyed, I propose to prove in these pages that follow. I know that it means very different things to different people. But that is only because evil always takes advantage of ambiguity. I know it is praised with high professions of idealism and benevolence, with silver-tongued rhetoric about purer motherhood and a happier posterity. But that is only because evil is always flattered, as the Furies were called the gracious ones. I know that it numbers many disciples whose intentions are entirely innocent and humane, and who would be sincerely astonished at my describing it as I do. But that is only because evil always wins through the strength of its splendid dupes, and there has in all ages been a disastrous alliance between abnormal innocence and abnormal sin. Of these who are deceived I shall speak, of course, as we all do of such instruments, judging them by the good they think they are doing and not by the evil which they really do. But eugenics itself does exist for those who have sense enough to see that ideas exist, and eugenics itself, in large quantities or small, coming quickly or coming slowly, urged from good motives or bad, applied to 1,000 people or applied to 3, eugenics itself is a thing no more to be bargained about than poisoning. It is not really difficult to sum up the essence of eugenics, though some of the eugenicists seem to be rather vague about it. The movement consists of 2 parts, a moral basis which is common to all, and a scheme of social application which varies a good deal. For the moral basis, it is obvious that man's ethical responsibility varies with his knowledge of consequences. If I were in charge of a baby, like Dr. Johnson in that Tower of Vision, and if the baby was ill through having eaten the soap, I might possibly send for a doctor. I might be calling him away from much more serious cases, from the bedside of babies whose diet had been far more deadly. But I should be justified. I could not be expected to know enough about his other patients to be obliged or even entitled to sacrifice to them the baby for whom I was primarily and directly responsible. Now the eugenic moral basis is this, that the baby for whom we are primarily and directly responsible is the babe unborn. That is, that we know or may come to know enough of certain inevitable tendencies in biology to consider the fruit of some contemplated union in that direct and clear light of conscience which we can now only fix on the other partner in that union. The one duty can conceivably be as definite or more definite than the other. The baby that does not exist can be considered even before the wife who does. Now it is essential to grasp that it is a comparatively new note in morality. Of course, sane people always thought the aim of marriage was the procreation of children to the glory of God or according to the plan of nature. But whether they counted such children as God's reward for service or nature's premium on sanity, they always left the reward to God or the premium to nature as a less definable thing. The only person, and this is the point, towards whom one could have precise duties was the partner in the process. Directly considering the partner's claims was the nearest one could get to indirectly considering the claims of posterity. If the woman of the harem sang praises of the hero as the Moslem mounted his horse, it was because this was the due of a man. If the Christian knight helped his wife off her horse, it was because this was the due of a woman. Definite and detailed dues of this kind they did not predicate of the babe unborn, regarding him in that agnostic and opportunistic light in which Mr. Brodie regarded the hypothetical child of Miss Squeers. Thinking these sex relations healthy, they naturally hoped they would produce healthy children. But that was all. The Moslem woman doubtless expected Allah to send beautiful sons to an obedient wife, but she would not have allowed any direct vision of such sons to alter the obedience itself. She would not have said, "I will now be a disobedient wife, as the learned leech informs me that great prophets are often the children of disobedient wives." The knight doubtless hoped that the saints would help him to strong children, if he did all the duties of his station, one which might be helping his wife off her horse. But he would not have refrained from doing this because he had read in a book that a course of falling off horses often resulted in the birth of a genius. Both Moslem and Christian would have thought such speculations not only impious but utterly unpractical. I quite agree with him, but that is not the point here. The point here is that a new school believes eugenics against ethics, and it is proved by one familiar fact that the heroisms of history are actually the crimes of eugenics. The eugenicists' books and articles are full of suggestions that non-eugenic unions should and may come to be regarded as we regard sins, and we should really feel that marrying an invalid is a kind of cruelty to children. But history is full of the praises of people who have held sacred such ties to invalids, of cases like those of Colonel Hutchinson and Sir William Temple, who remained faithful to betrothals when beauty and health had been apparently blasted. And though the illnesses of Dorothy Osborne and Mrs. Hutchinson may not fall under the eugenic speculations, I do not know, it is obvious that they might have done so, and certainly it would not have made any difference to men's moral opinion of the act. I do not discuss here which morality I favor, but I insist that they are opposite. The eugenicist really sets up as saints the very men whom hundreds of families have called sneaks. To be consistent, they ought to put up statues to men who deserted their loves because of bodily misfortune, with inscriptions celebrating the good eugenicist who, on his fiancée falling off a bicycle, nobly refused to marry her, or to the young hero who, on hearing an uncle with erysipelas, magnanimously broke his word. What is perfectly plain is this, that mankind have hitherto held the bond between man and woman so sacred, and the effect of it on the children so incalculable, that they have always admired the maintenance of honour more than the maintenance of safety. Doubtless they thought that even the children might be none the worse for not being the children of cowards and shirkers. But this was not the first thought, the first commandment. Briefly, we may say that while many moral systems have set restraints on sex almost as severe as any eugenicist could set, they have almost always had the character of securing the fidelity of the two sexes to each other and leaving the rest to God. To introduce an ethic which makes the fidelity or infidelity vary with some calculation about heredity is that rarest of all things, a revolution that has not happened before. It is only right to say here, though this matter should only be touched on, that many eugenicists would contradict this in so far as to claim that there was consciously eugenic reason for the horror of those unions which begin with the celebrated denial to man of the privilege of marrying his grandmother. Dr. S. R. Steinmetz, with that creepy simplicity of mind with which the eugenicists chill the blood, remarks that we do not yet know quite certainly what were the motives for the horror of that horrible thing which is the agony of Oedipus. With entirely amiable intention, I ask Dr. S. R. Steinmetz to speak for himself. I know the motives for regarding a mother or sister as separate from other women, nor have I reached them by any curious researches. I found them where I found an analogous aversion to eating a baby for breakfast. I found them in a rooted detestation in the human soul to liking a thing in one way when you already like it in another quite incompatible way. Now, it is perfectly true that this aversion may have acted eugenically, and so had a certain ultimate confirmation and basis in the laws of procreation. But there really cannot be any eugenicist quite so dull as not to see that this is not a defense of eugenics, but a direct denial of eugenics. If something which has been discovered at last by the lamp of learning is something which has been acted on from the first by the light of nature, this, so far as it goes, is plainly not an argument for pestering people, but an argument for letting them alone. If men did not marry their grandmothers when it was, for all they knew, a most hygienic habit, if we now know that they instinctively avoided scientific peril, that, so far as it goes, is a point in favor of letting people marry anyone they like. It is simply the statement that sexual selection, or what Christians call falling in love, is part of a man which in the rough and in the long run can be trusted. And that is the destruction of the whole of this science at a blow. The second part of the definition, the persuasive or coercive methods to be employed, I shall deal with more fully in the second part of this book, but some such summary as the following may here be useful. Far into the unfathomable past of our race, we find the assumption that the founding of a family is the personal adventure of a free man. Before slavery sank slowly out of sight under the new climate of Christianity, it may or may not be true that slaves were in some sense bred like cattle, valued as promising stock for labor. If it was so, it was so in a much looser and vaguer sense than the breeding of the eugenicists, and such modern philosophers read into the old paganism a fantastic pride and cruelty which are wholly modern. It may be, however, that pagan slaves had some shadow of the blessings of the eugenicist care. It is quite certain that the pagan freeman would have killed the first man that suggested it. I mean, suggested it seriously. For Plato was only a Bernard Shaw, who unfortunately made his jokes in Greek. Among free men, the law, more often the creed, most commonly of all, the custom, have laid all sorts of restrictions on sex for this reason or that. But law and creed and custom have never concentrated heavily except upon fixing and keeping the family when once it had been made. The act of founding the family, I repeat, was an individual adventure outside the frontiers of the state. Our first forgotten ancestors left this tradition behind them, and our own latest fathers and mothers a few generations ago would have thought us lunatics to be discussing it. The shortest general definition of eugenics on its practical side is that it does, in a more or less degree, propose to control some families, at least, as if they were families of pagan slaves. I shall discuss later the question of the people to whom this pressure may be applied, and the much more puzzling question of what people will apply it. But it is to be applied, at the very least, by somebody to somebody, and that on certain calculations about breeding which are affirmed to be demonstrable. So much for the subject itself. I say that this thing exists. I define it as closely as matters involving moral evidence can be defined. I call it eugenics. After that, anyone chooses to say that eugenics is not the Greek for this, I am content to answer that chivalrous is not the French for horsey, and that such controversial games are more horsey than chivalrous. End of chapter 1. Eugenics and Other Evils by G.K. Chesterton. Part 1, The False Theory. Chapter 2, The First Obstacles. Now, before I set about arguing these things, there is a cloud of skirmishers, of harmless and confused modern skeptics who ought to be cleared off or calmed down before we come to debate with the real doctors of the heresy. If I sum up my statement thus, eugenics, as discussed, evidently means the control of some men over the marriage and unmarriage of others, and probably means the control of the few over the marriage and unmarriage of the many, I shall first of all receive the sort of answers that float like skim on the surface of teacups and talk. I may very well, roughly and rapidly, divide these preliminary objectors into five sects, whom I will call the euphemists, the causists, the autocrats, the precedenters, and the endeavourers. When we have answered the immediate protestation of all these good, shouting, short-sighted people, we can begin to do justice to those intelligence that are really behind the idea. Most eugenicists are euphemists. I mean merely that short words startle them, while long words soothe them, and they are utterly incapable of translating the one into the other, however obviously they mean the same thing. Say to them, the persuasive and even coercive powers of the citizen should enable him to make sure that the burden of longevity in the previous generation does not become disproportionate and intolerable, especially to the females. Say this to them, and they will sway slightly to and fro like babies sent to sleep in cradles. say to them, "Murder your mother," and they sit up quite suddenly. Yet the two sentences, in cold logic, are exactly the same. Say to them, "It is not improbable that a period may arrive when narrow, if once useful, distinction between the anthropoid homo and the other animals, which has been modified on so many moral points, may be modified also even in regard to the important question of the extension of human diet." Say this to them, and beauty born of murmuring sound will pass into their face. But say to them in a simple, manly, hearty way, "Let's eat a man," and their surprise is quite surprising. Yet the sentences say just the same thing. Now, if anyone thinks these two instances extravagant, I will refer to two actual cases from the eugenic discussions. When Sir Oliver Lodge spoke of methods of the stud farm, many eugenicists exclaimed against the crudity of the suggestion. Yet long before that, one of the ablest champions in the other interest had written, "What nonsense this education is! Who could educate a racehorse or a greyhound?" Which most certainly means either nothing or the human stud farm. Or again, when I spoke of people being married forcibly by the police, another distinguished eugenicist almost achieved high spirits in his hearty assurance that no such thing had ever come into their heads. Yet a few days later I saw a eugenicist's pronouncement to the effect that the state ought to extend its powers in this area. The state can only be that corporation which men permit to employ compulsion, and this area can only be the area of sexual selection. I mean somewhat more than an idle jest when I say that the policeman will generally be found in that area. But I willingly admit that the policeman who looks after weddings will be like the policeman who looks after wedding presents. He will be in plain clothes. I do not mean that a man in blue with a helmet will drag a bride and groom to the altar. I do mean that nobody that man in blue is told to arrest will even dare to come near a church. Sir Oliver did not mean that men would be tied up in stables and scrubbed down by grooms. He meant that they would undergo a less of liberty, which to men is even more infamous. He meant that the only formula important to eugenicists would be "by Smith out of Jones." Such a formula is one of the shortest in the world, and is certainly the shortest way with the euphemists. The next sect of superficial objectors is even more irritating. I have called them, for immediate purposes, the causists. Suppose I say I dislike this spread of cannibalism in the West End restaurants. Somebody is sure to say, "Well, after all, Queen Eleanor, when she sucked blood from her husband's arm, was a cannibal." What is one to say to such people? One can only say, "Confine yourself to sucking poisoned blood from people's arms, and I permit you to call yourself by the glorious title of cannibal." In this sense, people say of eugenics, "After all, whenever we discourage a schoolboy from marrying a mad negress with a humpback, we are really eugenicists." Again, one can only answer, "Confine yourselves strictly to such schoolboys as are naturally attracted to humpback negresses, and you may exult in the title of eugenist. All the more proudly, because that distinction will be rare." But surely, anyone's common sense must tell him that if eugenics dealt only with such extravagant cases, it would be called common sense and not eugenics. The human race has excluded such absurdities for unknown ages and has never yet called it eugenics. You may call it flogging when you hit a choking gentleman on the back. You may call it torture when a man unfreezes his fingers at the fire. But if you talk like that a little longer, you will cease to live among living men. If nothing but this mad minimum of accident were involved, there would be no such thing as a eugenic congress, and certainly no such thing as this book. I had thought of calling the next sort of superficial people the idealists, but I think this implies a humility towards impersonal good they hardly show. So I call them the autocrats. They are those who give us generally to understand that every modern reform will work all right because they will be there to see. Where they will be and for how long they do not explain very clearly. I do not mind their looking forward to numberless lives in succession, for that is the shadow of a human or divine hope. But even a theosophist does not expect to be a vast number of people at once, and these people most certainly propose to be responsible for a whole movement after it has left their hands. Each man promises to be about 1,000 policemen, and if you ask them how this or that will work, they will answer, "Oh, I would certainly insist on this," or "I would never go so far as that," as if they could return to this earth and do what no ghost has ever done quite successfully, force men to forsake their sins. Of these, it is enough to say that they do not understand the nature of a law any more than the nature of a dog. If you let loose a law, it will do as a dog does. It will obey its own nature, not yours. Such sense as you have put into the law or the dog will be fulfilled, but you will not be able to fulfill a fragment of anything you have forgotten to put into it. Along with such idealists should go the strange people who seem to think that you can consecrate and purify any campaign forever by repeating the names of the abstract virtues that its better advocates had in mind. These people will say, "So far from aiming at slavery, the eugenicists are seeking true liberty, liberty from disease and degeneracy, etc." Or they will say, "We can assure Mr. Chesterton that the eugenicists have no intention of segregating the harmless. Justice and mercy are the very motto of..." To this kind of thing, perhaps the shortest answer is this: many of those who speak thus are agnostic, or generally unsympathetic to official religion. Suppose one of them said, "The Church of England is full of hypocrisy." What would he think of me if I answered, "I assure you that hypocrisy is condemned by every form of Christianity and is particularly repudiated in the prayer book"? Suppose he said that the Church of Rome had been guilty of great cruelties. What would he think of me if I answered, "The Church is expressly bound to meekness and charity and therefore cannot be cruel"? This kind of people need not detain us long. Then there are others whom I may call the precedenters, who flourish particularly in Parliament. They are best represented by the solemn official who said the other day that he could not understand the clamour against the feeble-minded bill, as it only extended the principles of the old lunacy laws. To which again one can only answer, "Quite so. It only extends the principle of the lunacy laws to persons without a trace of lunacy. This lucid politician finds an old law, let us say about keeping lepers in quarantine. He simply alters the word lepers to long-nosed people and says blandly that the principle is the same." Perhaps the weakest of all are those helpless persons whom I have called the Endeavourers. The prize specimen of them was another MP who defended the same bill as an honest attempt to deal with a great evil, as if one had a right to dragoon and enslave one's fellow citizens as a kind of chemical experiment, in a state of reverent agnosticism about what would come out of it. But with this fatuous notion that one can deliberately establish the Inquisition or the Terror, and then faintly trust the larger hope, I shall have to deal more seriously in a subsequent chapter. It is enough to say here that the best thing the honest Endeavourer could do would be to make an honest attempt to know what he is doing, and not to do anything else until he has found out. Lastly, there is a class of controversialists so hopeless and futile that I have really failed to find a name for them. But whenever anyone attempts to argue rationally for or against any existent and recognizable thing, such as the eugenic class of legislation, there are always people who begin to chop hay about socialism and individualism and say, "You object to all state interference. I am in favor of state interference. You are an individualist. I, on the other hand," etc. To which I can only answer with heartbroken patience that I am not an individualist, but a poor, fallen, but baptized journalist who is trying to write a book about eugenists, several of whom he has just met, whereas he never met an individualist and is by no means certain he would recognize him if he did. In short, I do not deny, but strongly affirm, the right of the state to interfere to cure a great evil. I say that in this case it would interfere to create a great evil, and I am not going to be turned from the discussion of that direct issue to bottomless botherations about socialism and individualism, or the relative advantages of always turning to the right and always turning to the left. And for the rest, there is undoubtedly an enormous mass of sensible, rather thoughtless people whose rooted sentiment is that any deep change in our society must be in some way infinitely distant. They cannot believe that men in hats and coats like themselves can be preparing a revolution. All their Victorian philosophy has taught them that such transformations are always slow. Therefore, when I speak of eugenic legislation or the coming of the eugenic state, they think of it as something like the time machine, or looking backward, a thing that, good or bad, will have to fit itself into their great-great-grandchild, who may be very different and may like it, and who in any case is a rather distant relative. To all this I have, to begin with, a very short and simple answer. The eugenic state has begun. The first of the eugenic laws has already been adopted by the government of this country and passed, with the applause of both parties, through the dominant House of Parliament. This first eugenic law clears the ground and may be said to proclaim negative eugenics, but it cannot be defended, and nobody has attempted to defend it except on the eugenic theory. I will call it the feeble-minded bill, both for brevity and because the description is strictly accurate. It is quite simply and literally a bill for incarcerating as madmen those whom no doctor will consent to call mad. It is enough if some doctor or other may happen to call them weak-minded. Since there is scarcely any human being to whom this term has not been conversationally applied by his own friends and relatives on some occasion or other, unless his friends and relatives have been lamentably lacking in spirit, it can be clearly seen that this law, like the early Christian Church, to which, however, it presents points of dissimilarity, is a net drawing in all kinds. It must not be supposed that we have a stricter definition incorporated in the bill. Indeed, the first definition of feeble-minded in the bill was much looser and vaguer than the phrase feeble-minded itself. It is a piece of yawning idiocy about persons who, though capable of earning their living under favorable circumstances, as if anyone could earn his living if circumstances were directly unfavorable to his doing so, are nevertheless incapable of managing their affairs with proper prudence, which is exactly what all the world and his wife are saying about their neighbors all over the planet. But as an incapacity for any kind of thought is now regarded as statesmanship, there is nothing so very novel about such slovenly drafting. What is novel, and what is vital, is this: that the defense of this crazy coercion act is a eugenic defense. It not only openly said, it is eagerly urged that the aim of the measure is to prevent any person whom these propagandists do not happen to think intelligent from having any wife or children. Every tramp who is sulky, every laborer who is shy, every rustic who is eccentric, can quite easily be brought under such conditions as were designed for homicidal maniacs. That is the situation, and that is the point. England has forgotten the feudal state. It is in the last anarchy of the industrial state. There is much in Mr. Belloc's theory that it is approaching the servile state.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.